Sandhan. All Gujarat Integrated Classroom.
Satellite na madhyam thi jodti kadi, etle Sandhan.
Good morning, friends. This is Dr. Himanshu Srivastav. I have come from Anand Arts College, Sardar Patel University. With me in the studio, we have Dr. Suresh Gadvi. He has also come from Anand Arts College, Sardar Patel University. Friends, we have come here to discuss a topic that is Greek tragedy and Shakespearean tragedy. What we will be discussing today is the ancient theater, ancient Greek theater. We'll be showing you some photographs also, and if time permits, a clip or two. What we'll be focusing apart from that is the characteristics of Greek tragedy, later on Shakespearean tragedy, the greatest Greek dramaticians as well as their dramas. Slide please. If we begin with drama, there are two types of drama, tragedy and comedy. Tragedy deals with the dark side of life and comedy deals with the light side of life. Tragedy, it can be said that into ancient era it was a serious drama, into medieval it was a story with unhappy close, modern it was a drama with unhappy close. Now if we start with the origin of tragedy, it is said that dithyram, a choral song in honor of Dionysus, god Dionysus, Arian of Mithibna in the 7th century, was the first to write a choral song. It was then later on practiced and was performed. Lysis of Hermione was the first to do it. It was done in the honor of god Dionysus. It was a worship. It was celebrated for god Dionysus, who was the god of wine. It was performed in a circular dancing place, which is known as orchestra. I'll be showing you the picture of it. A chorus of men used to come dressed in goat skin, because it was known as tragedia. Am I right, sir?
Yeah, yeah.
Which is known as goat song. When was this tragedy performed? It was performed into city Dionysia, Athens, into end of March. This is what something that we have to take into consideration. Into ruler Dionysia, into December, and into Lenia. It was into either January or early February. Into almost every Greek city, there were theaters, which nowadays we know as we come to know as amphitheaters. Theaters may be huge, they may be small, and each theater had specific parts, and usually they were located in the center of cities so that people can come around from all the places. Where and how were the dramas performed? It was into amphitheater. The photograph may make things clear. They used to wear masks, which was one of the major features of Greek tragedy. These are some of the photographs of the masks that they used to wear. Let us have now a quick glimpse over how the structure of the theater was. The left photo will show you the cartoon sketch of it, and the right the real picture of it. This was the stage, the different parts of stage, which I'll be discussing some photographs. This was one of the most important photographs because here in the background you can see the yellow building that, you know, that was used for the theater artist to perform. They used to come, and it was known as skeen. This is the sketch, and now we'll be focusing on which are the important parts of an amphitheater. This is known as orchestra or dancing circle, served as a primary acting area. Here the actors used to come dance. Now let us focus on this portion, which is known as the scene building. It was consisted of a building behind the orchestra, probably used as a dressing room, later to be integrated into stage action. The third important area is this, which was known as periacte, which was a revolving triangular device with one scene painted on each side, so that, you know, to change the scene, you would just, you know, change the shape of the triangle, and the scene used to be changed. Now these are certain photographs. Dionysus Theater in Athens, the sketch of it, one of the most important and famous theaters of Epidaurus. Paragnon. There were three major Greek tragedy writers: Aeschylus, Sophocles, and Euripides. Right, sir? Their major works are as described, as it is on the right hand side of your screen. Aeschylus was born in 524 BC, as it is primarily accepted, and his major fame rests on Seven Against Thebes and Orestia. Sophocles is Oedipus the King and Antigone, and Euripides is Medea. Let us try to focus on these dramatists. They were all active in the 5th century. Each had a competition and each has won some or the other prizes, where Euripides was last to win minimum prizes. If I talk about Aeschylus, he has written 80 plays, and about among all those 80 plays, Orestia, his fame rests on Orestia. It was Aeschylus who added a second actor to plays. He was concerned basically with the problems of guilt and punishment over several generations. If you talk about Sophocles, he was not concerned about the problems of guilt and punishment the way Aeschylus was, but he dealt with a specific struggle of a strong individual against life. Oedipus rests and Antigone are the major dramas of Sophocles. Let us concentrate on Euripides. Expresses weariness and disillusionment of war-torn years at the end of the 5th century. He was basically concerned for realism and a determination to expose social, political, and religious injustice. He believes in the existence of irrational forces, gods, but he does not deem them worthy of respect. His fame rests on Medea, as I've already mentioned. These are the parts of the tragedy which sir would be discussing into detail, but roughly a Greek tragedy was divided into these portions: of prologue, which was consisted of a first act, parados, episodes, statisma, and exodus. Acts, choral odes, action after this. This was a pattern, a common pattern which all the three dramatists, they followed. Now, for the further discussion about the definition of tragedy, Aristotle gave a definition of tragedy. I would request sir to continue. Sir.
Thank you, Himanshu Srivastava. Friends, Dr. Himanshu Srivastava threw some light on the Greek theater and the great writers of Greek tragedy. Now, I would like to begin my discussion with Aristotle. 5th century BC. As Dr. Himanshu Srivastava pointed out, was the golden period for the Greek tragedy. There were three major writers of tragedy in that particular century. First was Aeschylus, second was Sophocles, and the youngest of the three was Euripides. Now, it is said that they wrote many tragedies. For example, Sophocles is said to have written more than 120 tragedies, but only 7 of them have come down to us. So they were the great tragedy writers of the 5th century BC in Greek. In the 4th century BC came Aristotle, and he wrote a treatise on poetry. The title of his treatise, as you all know, is The Poetics. It was written in 330 BC. Now, in writing this treatise, if we categorize the poetics into 5 parts, we can see that the second part deals with tragedy. And in his theory of tragedy, Aristotle has based himself on these three great tragedians of the Greek drama. As Dr. Himanshu at the outset pointed out, from the earliest times, drama has been divided into 2 broad categories, tragedy and comedy. The atmosphere of tragedy is somber and serious. The atmosphere of a comedy is mirthful and light. Secondly, a tragedy aims at evoking the emotions of pity and awe, the emotions of pity and fear, while a comedy aims at evoking our laughter. So tragedy particularly deals with human suffering, the suffering of a human being. Aristotle, as I pointed out in the beginning, based himself on the plays, on the tragedies written by the three great Greek masters. Let us begin with his definition of tragedy. In the sixth chapter of the Poetics, he defines tragedy like this. Tragedy is an imitation of an action which is serious, complete in itself, and of a certain length. It is expressed in speech, made beautiful in different ways in different parts of the play. It is acted, not narrated, by exciting pity and fear. It gives a healthy relief to such emotions. This is the definition of tragedy given by Aristotle, and scholars have discussed it at length. Now let us discuss what Aristotle wants to say in this definition. Let us see it sentence after sentence. Next. Tragedy, he says in the opening of his, or in the very beginning of his definition, tragedy is an imitation of an action. That means tragedy is an imitation. Aristotle says that imitation is a fundamental human instinct. Man imitates the objects of nature around him by practice or by habit. All arts, Aristotle says, are imitative. Tragedy is also an imitative art. Here, what has been imitated is action. By action, Aristotle means human action. The object of, so far as the object of imitation is concerned, it is human actions, right? The action should be serious. Here, the tragedy differs from comedy, which deals with non-serious actions. But the action in a tragedy should be serious. It should be complete. The action of a tragedy should be complete. Complete means it must have an organic quality. And it must have a beginning, a middle, and an end. It must be complete in itself. All the parts must be related with each other. It must not be incomplete in any way. The language of a comedy, the language of tragedy should be embellished. So here it differs from epic. So far as the, you see, manner of imitation is concerned, Aristotle says that the language of a tragedy should be embellished. Embellished in the sense that dialogues in, you see, verse in dialogues and songs in the choral part of the tragedy. It should be in the form of action and not narration. Here, tragedy differs from epic. In an epic, the things are narrated, but in a tragedy, it is in the form of, the action is, the presentation is in the form of action and not narration. Next. It should arouse pity and fear. Very important thing about the tragedy is this. When we watch a tragedy being enacted on the stage, it arouses in us the emotions of pity and fear. It is the function of tragedy. It should effect proper catharsis of the emotions of pity and fear. We'll discuss it later, what Aristotle says, or what Aristotle means when he uses this word catharsis. Next. Yes. According to Aristotle, there are six formative elements in a tragedy. The first is plot. And Aristotle believes, according to Aristotle, plot is the first thing in a tragedy. He says that a tragedy can be without characters. Tragedy may not have good characters. It is possible to have a tragedy without characters, but without plot, tragedy is not possible. The very existence of tragedy is not possible without the plot. So plot, according to Aristotle, is the soul of a tragedy. The second is character. In the order of merit, character comes at the second place. Character deals with or shows us the moral purpose of the writer. and the character by showing what the showing the things which a man accepts and the things that a man rejects, the things that he does, the things that he does not do.
The third is?
Yes, the third is diction. Diction means language. Aristotle believes that the language of a tragedy should be embellished. He is in favor of metaphorical language. Language, it is through language that the thoughts and feelings of a character are expressed. They are, you see, translated through the thoughts and feelings of the character are translated through the thought. I'm sorry, the language. The fourth is thought. Thought means what a person wants to do and what he does not want to do. So, it is the expression of what a man is, what the character is, what he wants to do. His thoughts gives us or give us the idea of what he wants to do. Next is spectacle or the scenic effect. And Aristotle says that a dramatist must not depend much on spectacle. He must depend on his own skill of writing a drama. He should depend on his art rather than on spectacle. Last in the list, the sixth element of tragedy or the sixth part of tragedy is song. Song is to be found in the choral part of the tragedy, and it beautifies the language, it beautifies and decorates the tragedy, and it also provides us with pleasure. Next. Yes. Then Aristotle discusses at length the plot in a tragedy. According to him, plot is the most important constituent of tragedy. It is the soul of tragedy. Aristotle talks of two types of plot. The first is simple plot, the second is complex plot. Simple plot moves forward, the action in a simple plot moves forward without sudden or violent changes. Such plots, simple plots, are without peripety and discovery. Complex plot involves peripety or discovery or both. Now let us discuss what is peripety and discovery. Peripety, Aristotle defines peripety as the change in the situation, the change in the condition, the change in the status of things, the change in the things to its opposite. By discovery, he means the recognition of truth. And according to Aristotle, that discovery is of the best type, which is accompanied by or which is which has with it peripety. And for this, he gives the example of Sophocles' play, Oedipus the King. He says that the discovery that is found in Oedipus the King is of the best type. He gives the example why. He tells us why. The messenger, I hope all of you know the story or know what happens in the play Oedipus the King. The messenger from Corinth comes and tells Oedipus about the death of his foster mother, Menove. I'm sorry, his father Polybus, his foster father Polybus is no more. But Oedipus does not want to go to Corinth because still there is one thing in his mind, there is a fear in his mind that according to Oracle, he was supposed to establish physical relationship with his mother also. So he shows his unwillingness to go back to Corinth. But the messenger who wants to relieve Oedipus of the fear, he wants to make him free from the fear, tells him something else. He says that, don't worry, my lord, Menope is not your real mother. She is not your biological mother. You are the son of somebody else, but you were only brought up by Polybus and Menope. Now this discovery brings certain changes in the life of Oedipus, and then we see that he falls upon evil days. Ultimately, he blinds himself and he finds himself in a very difficult situation. So according to Aristotle, this is the best example of Oedipus the king is the best example of discovery. Next. Yes. Then he gives some conditions for, he points out some conditions for a good plot. Aristotle says that a perfectly good man in the plot of a tragedy, a perfectly good man must not be seen passing from happiness to misery. Right? Because if a man is perfectly good, the emotion of pity will not be aroused in us because he is not like us. And we feel pity for the people like us. So there will not be the, it will fail to arouse the emotion of pity. Secondly, the fall of a perfectly good man will definitely shock us, but it will not arouse the emotion of fear in us. The second thing, a bad man must not be seen rising from misery to happiness, because this will not satisfy the sense of morality in us. It will disturb our moral sense. So Aristotle says that a perfectly evil person will not be shown to move from misery to happiness. And the third important thing is, an extremely bad man must not be seen falling from happiness to misery, because again this will not evoke the emotions of pity and fear, because the fall of an extremely bad person will definitely not disturb us greatly. Next. Then comes, once again, there are certain things that Aristotle throws light on. Plot must deal with an action which is possible according to the laws of probability and necessity. Right? So this means, in a tragedy, the dramatist must not include anything that is not relevant. Every episode, every incident included, covered in a tragedy must be relevant, and different incidents must be interrelated with each other, and they must take place according to the laws of probability and necessity. By probability and necessity, he says that one more thing that he tells us about probability is that the action must be convincing or credible. If it is not that, we will not be interested in it. They must be probable. Sometimes it so happens that we feel that certain things are not probable in life, but it is the art of the dramatist which present such things in a probable manner. And that's why Aristotle says that it is better to present, unconvincing things in a probable way than to present probable things in an unconvincing manner. Right? So probability and necessity are very important ingredients of a tragedy. Next thing is that the poet should take, or the poet or the writer of a tragedy, the dramatist, the poet should take great care to make his denouement or resolutions effective. Yes, resolution or denouement means the unraveling of, incidents, unraveling of things. That should be done in a very effective manner. If this does not happen, the audience, the spectators will not be satisfied in the least. The third thing is that Aristotle disapproves of the plots with a double end. The plots with double end means happiness for some characters and misery for others. So this type of end, double end, Aristotle says weakens the tragic effect. So this must not happen. The tragedy must happen, must end with catastrophe. There must be unhappiness for most of the characters in a tragedy. Next. Characterization. Next comes characterization. Aristotle says the characters must be good. He says that they must be good, but not too good. Characters must be good. By good he means fine or noble. The character should be good, but must not be too good. Because if a good person passes from happiness to misery, then only the arousal of the emotions of pity and fear will be possible. Next is the second thing is the characters must be appropriate. By appropriate he means that the characters must be true to their status. They must be true to their type. For example, if a woman is presented or introduced in a tragedy, she must behave the way a woman is supposed to behave. She must behave like a woman. She must not be manly, right? If a king is introduced in a drama, in a tragedy, then he must behave what a king is traditionally supposed to behave. Aristotle says that if the story has been taken from any myth or history, the dramatist should see that the characters behave exactly the way those characters were supposed to behave. He gives the example once again of Oedipus. If a character plays the role of Oedipus the king, then he must behave the way Oedipus is supposed to behave in his days. So here also, once again, I would like to draw your attention to one thing, that Aristotle has in his mind the Greek tragedies in which the characters from history, myth were drawn, right? Next is the characters must have likeness. That means they must be like us. They must be true to life. If the characters are like us, then only we'll get involved with them. Then only we'll be interested in them. If they are not like us, if they are not, in certain things, ordinary people like us, then they will fail to interest us in any way. And the last is the character must be consistent, right? They must be true to their nature. By consistent, Aristotle means that the characters must be true to their nature, right? Now, if a character is introduced as a rash and impulsive character, then he must be consistently rash and impulsive throughout the tragedy, right? And that's why Aristotle says that if an inconsistent character is introduced in a tragedy, he must be consistently inconsistent throughout the play, right? Next slide. Then Aristotle talks of the tragic hero. He discusses in detail the characteristics of an ideal tragic hero. And he says that the tragic hero should be good, but not too good. Once again, the same thing. If he is not good, feel any respect and reverence for him. We won't feel ourselves attached to him in any way. But he must not be too good, because if he is too good, then the emotions of pity and fear will not be aroused. Once again, I would like to repeat the same thing, that if he is very good, if he is too good, then the emotion of pity will not be aroused, because he is not like us. And if he is too bad, then there is no problem of the arousal of pity and fear. Secondly, the tragic hero should not be an utterly wicked person. If he is utterly wicked, then will our sense of justice will be satisfied, because the fall of an utterly wicked person will please us, but there will not be problem of, there will be no question of the arousal of the emotions of pity and fear. The third thing is, he falls from a position of lofty eminence. He is on a, very high status, and he falls from that position. For example, a king, Oedipus king, towards the end of the play we see that he blinds himself and he is exiled. So he falls from an eminent position. He should be of intermediate kind. Intermediate kind means he must not be too good, he must not be too wicked a character, yes. Right? And last thing is the disaster which wrecks his life is not due to deliberate wickedness on his part, but due to hemartia. Hemartia is a very important word. And by hemartia, Aristotle means error of judgment. The character in the course of his actions commits a deed makes a mistake that proves to be fatal for him, and hemorrhagia can be committed in a number of circumstances. For example, it may be an outcome of ignorance of things. He does not know what is going on, what are the circumstances, and he commits hemorrhagia. He makes an error of judgment. Secondly, sometimes it so happens that he is careless in his view. He is hasty or careless in his view of things. Thirdly, sometimes it is a voluntary act, but then that is not done deliberately. For example, when a man does something in anger, that is a voluntary act, but that is something that has not been done deliberately. It was not his intention to do that. Once again, he says that hemorrhagia that is found in the case of Oedipus king is of the best kind. Because he commits a mistake. He commits error of judgment in the form of killing his own father Laius. He is unaware of the fact. He does not know the things around him. He does not know that Laius is his own father. When unknowingly he marries his own mother Jocasta, once again he is ignorant of the things. He does not know anything what is happening with him, and that's why he commits a mistake. There is an error of judgment in his case. Next, yes. Fate plays a vital role in bringing the catastrophe. In Greek tragedy, fate has a very significant role to play. As once again, I would like to give the example of Oedipus king. Whatever we know that was his error of judgment, that he killed his father and married his mother. But there is something we feel that while reading or watching a Greek play, Greek tragedy, we definitely feel that the things are predetermined. His actions, though he himself commits mistakes, we feel that the things that he has committed, the action he has done, were not his free choice. He was bound somewhere. It was knowingly or unknowingly that arbitrary power of fate that has worked. But sometimes it so happens that it is the sin of, in the case of Greek tragedy, sometimes it is the sins of forefathers that they are punished. The characters are punished because of the sins of their forefathers. Sometimes they have to suffer because of this arbitrary power of fate. Yes, the things are predetermined. The three unities, unity of action, once again, it must place. Have organic UC quality. We have already discussed it. It must have a beginning, middle, and end. And there is unity of time. Aristotle says that the tragedy, attempts as far as possible to remain within one revolution of the sun. That means 24 hours. Third is unity of place. That means unity of place means the place in a tragedy should not change. If the scene changes, it must not be too great a distance. Right now, Aristotle makes a mention of only unity of action, but these unities, it is seen that, or you must have observed that these unities, all the three unities, are observed in Greek tragedies. Next, functions of tragedy. Tragedy arouses the emotions of pity and fear, and in this way brings about the catharsis of these emotions. The Greek word catharsis has three meanings: purgation, purification, and clarification. Aristotle himself has not explained the term catharsis, though so scholars have tried to explain the word in their own ways. But in Greek, this particular word catharsis has three meanings: purgation. So some scholars likens this word with homeopathic treatment, in which like cures likes. So they believe that in a tragedy, our emotions of pity and fear are artificially excited, artificially evoked, but they purge the real emotions of pity and fear that are lying in us, right? The next thing is purification. The next theory is purification. Some critics believe, some scholars are of the opinion that catharsis means tragedy. The tragic action purifies our emotions removing the excess from it. We are purified of the excess and defects of our emotions of pity and fear. The third theory is clarification theory. That means by watching a tragedy, we have a better understanding of the universal law of things. By watching the incidents enacted on the stage in a tragedy, we get a better idea of life, and that means this, in this way, it clarifies the things, it clarifies the universal law of existence, universal law of life to us. Yes, next.
Now let us
discuss in brief Shakespearean tragedy. Shakespeare, as we all know, was a very great dramatist of the 16th century England, and he has written many tragedies. He has written some 37 plays in all, and he has also written many tragedies. Now, there are certain things which are common in the Greek tragedy and the Shakespearean tragedy. There are certain things in which Shakespeare differs from the concept of Greek tragedy. Let us discuss in brief the characteristics of a Shakespearean tragedy. In many ways, Shakespearean tragedy is a clear departure from the classical conception of tragedy. Shakespeare has not offered us any definition of tragedy, right? We have the theory of Greek tragedy in the form of the Poetics by Aristotle. But so far as Shakespeare's tragedy is concerned, he himself has not given us any conception of it, any theory of tragedy. But his view of tragedy is very much clear. We can have an idea of his view of tragedy from his own tragedy, the tragedies that he has written. Next. These are his four major tragedies: Hamlet, Othello, Macbeth, and King Lear. Characteristics of Shakespearean tragedy. No play at the end of which the hero remains alive is in the full Shakespearean sense a tragedy. Right? In a Shakespearean tragedy, the hero dies at the end. In Greek tragedy, this was not, a compulsion. In many of Greek tragedies also the hero dies, but we have the examples of many tragedies in which the hero does not die. No doubt, his suffering is 100 times worse than their life, but then some heroes do not die at the end of the tragedy. But in a Shakespearean tragedy, a hero definitely dies, and but this death of the hero is an instantaneous death as a result of any accident is not to be found in a Shakespearean tragedy. It is at the end of so many pain and suffering. He has to pass through a phase of sufferings, and at last the hero dies. For the Greek tragedy, for the Greeks, tragedy need not end in disaster, but a Shakespearean tragedy is in fact a tale of suffering and calamity conducting to death. It is said that the fifth act of a tragedy is most of the times that scene of the deathbed. Yes. A Shakespearean tragedy is a story of exceptional calamity. He has to suffer like anything. The hero has to suffer like anything, and that's why the emotions of pity and fear are aroused. They are excited. There are many characters in a Shakespearean tragedy, but it is concerned primarily with one person. In Greek tragedies, there are less characters than the Shakespearean tragedy. In the Shakespearean tragedy, we find many characters, but particularly, primarily, it is concerned with one person or two, hero and heroine. In the case of, Julius and Caesar, it is the tragedy of Brutus in one sense. In the case of Othello, there are two persons, the hero and the heroine, right? Othello and Desdemona. In the case of Macbeth, Macbeth and Lady Macbeth. In the case of Romeo and Juliet, Romeo and Juliet. Right? Yes. Shakespearean tragic hero is a person of high degree. He is a king or a prince, or he is a political leader, or he belongs to a very prestigious house. For example, Romeo and Juliet, they are not children of kings or princes, but they belong to very high family. Their houses are very prestigious in the society, and whatever happens in their houses becomes public issues. right? Public are interested in whatever happens in their houses. Next thing, Shakespeare's tragic hero is a person of high degree. His actions and sufferings are also of an unusual kind. His nature is also exceptional. It is not that his calamity, his suffering is exceptional. At the same time, his nature is also exceptional. They have certain things in them that raise them. Raise them in our eyes, and it seems that they are above the average humanity, right? For example, Brutus is a genius person, right? Macbeth or Othello are great warriors. Romeo is a genuine and great lover, right? So that nature, the nature of a Shakespearean tragic hero is also exceptional. Next, this is what Dr. Harrison has to say about a Shakespearean hero. Shakespearean hero is an embodiment of unbending courage, iron determination, and dynamic self-confidence. And like a true hero, jumps into the ocean of catastrophe, leaving in readers' mind an impression that could hardly be brushed aside. Next. The calamities of tragedy proceed mainly from actions, the actions of the hero. So, in a Shakespearean tragedy, it is said that the character is destiny. Whatever the hero suffers, it is because of his own mistake. Something that he has done, he has to suffer because of it. Yes, the hero always contribute. Friends, we'll have to conclude it within 5 minutes. The hero always contributes in some measure to the disaster in which he perishes. He errs by action or omission. Sometimes he acts, sometimes he omits. For example, you see the delay in the case of Hamlet. That is the omission of action, and that sometimes becomes the reason of his catastrophe. His error, joining with other causes, brings on him ruin. It is not that only his action. Sometimes it seems that the deed of the actor, the hero, the action of the hero is not solely responsible for whatever falls upon him or for his own fall. It joins with other causes as well. Next, conflict. We find conflict in Greek tragedy in the same way. There is an element of conflict in the Shakespearean tragedy as well. Conflict can be between two persons of whom the hero is one, right? We have the example of, Othello. There is a conflict between two persons, Othello and Iago, right? The hero is one, between two persons of whom the hero is one, or between two persons, two parties or two groups. The hero is a leader of one of them, as in the case of, Julius Caesar. On one side, there is Cassius and Brutus and others. On the other, there is Antony, there is Octavius, right, and others. Though the hero is responsible for, sometimes there is one more thing that I would like to make a mention of is, there is a conflict between two ideas or passions, right? So the idea of love is in conflict, idea of love in Romeo and Juliet is in conflict with the hatred of the families between the hero and the heroine, right? But Shakespeare also deals with the inner conflict as well as the outer conflict. There is external conflict as well as the internal conflict. For example, there is a conflict between the treacherous ambition of Macbeth and the, loyalty and patriotism in characters like Macduff or Malcolm. But at the same time, there is a conflict between the two of them. But these two elements also collide in the soul of Macbeth himself. There is a struggle between Claudius and Hamlet, but at the same time there is a conflict in the soul of Hamlet, and it is this internal conflict that interests us more. Next slide.
Just one or two more slides and then we'll be switching over.
Yeah.
If possible, just one or two more slides. Yes. Just 2 minutes.
We'll try to conclude it within 1 or 2 minutes.
I'll just like to discuss about the poetic justice. Yes. Sir, please.
Thank you.
poetic justice, you know, there is no poetic justice into a Shakespearean drama, which is one of the major characteristics of Shakespearean tragedy. We can have the basic difference between Greek tragedy and Shakespearean tragedy is that in a Greek tragedy, the plot is the first principle, the soul of a tragedy, character holds the second position. In a Shakespearean tragedy, character comes first. So, character is destiny and fate is responsible for his downfall. Later on, that's it. That was all. I hope you have enjoyed the session. We basically wanted to deal with the differences that that are in the Greek tragedy and Shakespearean tragedy. Is unity of time, place, and action, and fate, which fate is responsible for Greek tragedy, while so far as Shakespearean tragedy is concerned, it is the character that is.
Yes, what are the differences between a Greek tragedy and a Shakespearean tragedy?
That's all from the studio.
Yes,
we have.
Time does not permit.
I hope you have enjoyed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sandhan, All Gujarat Integrated Classroom.
Satellite na madhyam thi jodti kadi, etle Sandhan.